followed by Cover to Cover Open Book, and then Free Speech Radio News, and then Hard Knock Radio. So again, stay with us now for Education Today. While we await, hopefully, Kitty Kelly Epstein's imminent arrival, let's listen to her theme. We never really get an opportunity to hear the entire theme, which is Herbie Hancock. So stay with us.
Good afternoon and welcome to Education Today. I'm your host, Kitty Kelly Epstein. Today we will be talking with educators and graduate students from around the country about their experiences and their research with the now infamous federal law called No Child Left Behind. We've discussed this law on this program several times before and have pointed out some facts that I'll just review real quickly. One is that No Child Left Behind was pushed very vigorously by the National Business Roundtable, which is a body of CEOs of Fortune 500 companies. It was supported by both Republicans and Democrats. It limits local control and encourages such practices as scripted learning. And over the years that it has been in place, it has engendered quite a bit of controversy because of the effects that it has had on schools. Our first call is going to be with Carrie Holt in Atlanta, Georgia. Carrie is pursuing a doctorate and has been an educator for many years. She has also done quite an intensive study of No Child Left Behind and its impacts in Georgia. Welcome to the program, Carrie.
Good afternoon. Glad to be with you.
Wonderful to talk with you. Can you tell us something of the interesting things that you have found out about No Child Left Behind? I know one thing you did that you've mentioned to me is contacting a legislator and going to a town hall meeting, I believe, that he was holding, and that you both got some interesting information there and also got an interesting reaction to the law. You want to tell us about that?
I'd be happy to. I had been trying very hard to get in touch with my U.S. senator and representative, and I had not, unfortunately, had not been able to do that. And just about that same time, I heard of a town hall meeting that was going to be held by a former representative of mine. And so I decided to attend that town hall meeting, and I did. It was held on March 31st. When it came time for me to speak, I asked him about his opinion of No Child Left Behind and whether he planned to vote for its reauthorization or not. He said something interesting. He didn't directly answer my question. Instead, he said, let's pretend. I'm going to play dumb. I'm going to say that I don't know very much. I know some things about NLCB, but I don't know very much about it. So in the next 2 minutes, won't you tell me something about it and convince me that I should not vote for its reauthorization? Well, that left the door open for me, but it didn't leave it open very wide because I had only 2 minutes to respond. But I shared with him some of my reading, and much of what I have read, I'll admit, has been negative. I've been hard put to find, except for the Business Roundtable, many people, many organizations that support NLCB. So I shared with him first some of the information that I had read, some that had been shared with me by my classmates, that had been discussed with former coworkers of mine. And in particular, I'm concerned, and it was concerned, and I wanted him to know that the information that I had received that indicated that the law or that the act was succeeding, that is, that it was winning, that it was working, I was very disturbed when I took a very close look at that, and I think that's what you're referring to, Dr. Epstein, is that I took a very close look at what was being said with respect to that law working. And if you look very closely at it, on the surface, that appears to be true. For example, I looked at my state's AYP for the preceding school year, that will be 2005-06. And looking at those numbers at the elementary and middle grades, we did make small gains. There was a dramatic drop, however, at the high school level. And so then I wanted to look at an area that is of most interest to me, and that's at how well schools did in the urban areas, Metro Atlanta to be exact. And when I took a look at that, I could not believe what I was reading. I found just the opposite. In fact, I found only one tiny school system in Metro Atlanta that it met its AYP.
And what it, can you tell us what AYP is?
AYP is...
So it's some measure that's used by the federal government of whether a school has met its targets. I believe it stands for annual yearly progress.
Annual yearly progress.
But it's, they always use the initials for it. But I just wanted people to know that's kind of throughout the country, that's what the federal government talks about in terms of whether schools have met their targets. And actually, there are quite serious punishments if you don't. Okay, go ahead.
Exactly. And so looking at that, and I'm sorry that I'm so used to the alphabet education that I temporarily forgot that. But it is the standard to which schools are held. You know, you meet that target or you do not meet it. And as you said, if it is not met, then there can be some very serious consequences. But the point that was most startling to me is that no school system in the metro area met AYP.
None of them.
In fact, I pointed out to the congressman that the very school where this town hall meeting was being held, and I hate to put it this way because if you listen to those who support it, they don't like to use the word failed, but that school failed miserably. That school did not meet its AYP, And so I just wanted to share that with him. I was not trying to be combative. I just wanted him to know that while, you know, you look at those scores and if you look at the state as a whole, you see one picture. But if you narrow that down, and especially if you narrow it down, ironically, to those students for whom NCLB supposedly was intended to help, there is no progress.
And which students are those which it says it's going to help?
Okay, those are students who are located in the urban area. Those are the students who historically have done poorly on standardized tests.
And the number one goal or stated goal of NCLB is to reduce or eliminate what's called the achievement gap, which is the gap on test scores between white students and African-American and Latino students. In your research, has it succeeded in reducing the achievement gap?
I just can't see how I can say that it has. Based on, and I know that's been limited research, what I've done, but I think that if we look across the board, this is what I'm finding. As a matter of fact, the other day on one of the national news broadcasts, it was interesting to hear that the city of Houston, and of course that's one of the backbones of this law, so to speak. It is the proven test ground, so to speak, as far as I can understand. But Houston has decided that it will no longer use those standardized tests. It will go back to using end-of-year assessments.
So Houston isn't going to give standardized tests?
It's Houston, according to what
Amazing.
Was on the news the other day. They are no longer going to give those standardized tests.
And do you know how they're going to deal with the federal law, given that they're not giving the tests?
There was something interesting, which I didn't quite understand, that the superintendent said that because systems are allowed, or states, rather, are allowed to use their own measures for gaining or for judging whether they have been successful or not, or how well students have performed or not, that little clause allows them to continue to receive funds.
Very interesting. We need to look into that because it would seem that a lot of school districts would choose end-of-year assessments, which are certainly more based on what you're teaching in the classroom rather than just the sort of test prep that a lot of people feel they've been forced into. We're going to wrap up in just a minute. I just wanted you to finish your story about the legislator you spoke with. So what was his reaction to your two-minute presentation on No Child Left Behind?
Oh, I have to say that he was very pleased with it. As a matter of fact, he asked if I would assist him in becoming one of the best-informed legislators when it comes time to vote for reauthorization. And to that end, he has asked me to work with one of his aides, and I'm going to do that. In fact, we've already set up a couple of conferences. We're going to begin emailing each other next week, and then thereafter, we are going to hold telephone conferences. and we're going to discuss in detail some of the things, and more. And I'll have more time there than I had at that town hall meeting. But the follow-up is that we are going to be corresponding with one of his aides and then with him, and then hopefully I will get some kind of indication as to how he's going with it. But he was very, very pleased. As a matter of fact, the audience, to my surprise, I received a standing ovation.
Wow.
Number of parents there. And after the meeting had ended, they said to me, I'm so glad to hear some of the things that you're sharing with us, because we don't know very much about No Child Left Behind, or whatever you're calling it. They don't even know what it's called. They just know that their kids are having to take a number of tests, that they go to school on a regular basis, and during the course of two or three days each week, their kids are taking a steady test-taking skill. They're not studying the subjects, you know, as such. They're learning how to take tests. And I found that same thing in some of the literature that I read. Schools are becoming test prep schools.
Mm-hmm.
And so the bottom line is that, yes, I'm very pleased with the presentation. I think that I'm going to be able to share with the congressman, as I said, in more detail, some of the things that I've read and some of the things I've learned. And hopefully I can get his ear, and we can have a good dialogue about it.
Wonderful approach. Carrie's in a graduate program which utilizes something called action research. That is, you try to study the world in order to change it, to quote some famous man. People to actually do academic research by, you know, looking at statistics, reading journal articles, going out and interviewing people, various sorts of academic research. But they also combine that with trying to take action around the issues that they're discussing, trying to make changes at the same time that they're studying. And it's an approach that Carrie's obviously using very well, and is now in collaboration with a legislator in Atlanta, Georgia, who is concerned with the same issues, because those districts in the Atlanta metropolitan area, which are the districts that were supposed to be helped by No Child Left Behind, it appears that that's not the case and that there is quite a bit of opposition. Congratulations on your standing ovation, your good research, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you for the opportunity to participate.
Sure.
Good night.
Good night. Our next caller, the next person we're going to be talking with, is Sarah Cloutier. She's in Ukiah, California. Sarah coordinates the internship program for Western Governors University, which operates within the states of Texas, California, and Nevada at this time. Her background is in elementary education and administration, and her research interest now is in how her interns, who are first-year teachers, are being affected by No Child Left Behind. So, again, she is an educator herself. She has taught, and now she's teaching at the graduate level, teaching teachers or prospective teachers who are in their own classrooms and trying to discover from them what impact this law is having on them. Welcome, Sarah.
Thank you.
You want to tell us something about your conversations with your interns, how your research and your action are proceeding on this issue?
It's been very interesting. The interns across the three states that are currently in our internship program literally do not know what No Child Left Behind means. When I present those four words, it has to be explained. They just feel like learning to be a teacher is going into a classroom and preparing those students to meet quote-unquote standards. When we get further into our discussion about it, they're going, well, where is it that we teach the students to survive in the world today? Where are the basics taught? And the only two basics that they feel they really can address are math and sciences at this point, which in the literature of today, it's saying that's where No Child Left Behind is providing the emphasis. And I have to agree that they are being allowed only that time. They don't have time for any arts or social studies being left behind at this point. So that's very, very frustrating for me as someone who feels like the whole child needs to be educated, not part of the child.
So you feel frustrated in trying to educate people to be good teachers when you feel that the structure of the school prohibits them from doing what you consider good teaching?
Very much so. And I think that we're teaching our teachers how to create test takers, very much as Carrie was saying, that we are test-creating environments. We aren't there to educate the whole child. And I think that also a part of it is that these interns are seeing and have expressed the opinion that whole groups of students are being left behind.
I see.
And these students are the ones that, in some states, they're not even counting their test scores.
They're not counting their test scores.
Right. Either the district or the state has found some way that they don't have to include those, because the AYP, the academic yearly progress that the schools have to make, is such an important number, it takes precedence over what the students are learning.
You've also been doing some reading, right, of various authors discussing No Child Left Behind. I wonder if there's anything significant you've found from that part of your research.
Very much so. Actually, just recently when I was reading Jamie McKenzie and how the teachers that are being educated today are educated in a manner that is probably prior to the industrial age. We are taking our students backward. We are forgetting about the students that are disadvantaged and minority students. The ones that are making progress are the affluent and students that are in the suburban schools that are in advantaged areas.
And that, of course, is the opposite of what No Child Left Behind said
it
was going to do.
It is. We wanted to close the gap. The whole premise was that we close the gap in education and make education an equal opportunity area for all students. And that's not what has been shown by research. It shows that due, you know, to NCLB and inability to provide similar environments and materials for all students, we've widened the gap and not closed the gap.
Wow. Any other interesting authors or websites you could recommend to our listeners?
Susan O'Hara is one that I think needs to be read. And the NEA website, and these are NEA.com, or org, excuse me, that has a great deal of information on the 17, I believe there's one article on the 17 theories of what has failed. And then they provide also 17 areas where NCLB has succeeded. If you look at them, it would be interesting in how other people perceive them. I perceive them as being, they need to be in one column. They are the same. It's just stating it in a different manner.
Mm-hmm. So you mentioned two places people might look for other information. Susan Ohanian, it's O-H-A-N-I-A-N, has a website with a lot of materials and articles. And then the National Education Association has written quite a bit on this also.
And also nochildleft.org.
Nochildleft.org, okay.
Right.
Those sound like really useful resources. Do you... are you also concerned with the Business Roundtable influence? That's one question. And the other question, maybe related, is how do you feel about the likelihood of having change in No Child Left Behind? Do you feel like people are going to be able to create the kind of momentum that might change it or end it or rewrite it or whatever?
I have a negative feeling about change. However, if we don't stand up and go to websites where we can find and talk with our legislative people, we will not. We can guarantee that we won't have change. And having been a pretty passive person prior to this, I know that the only thing that I can do, rather than sit and complain, is to go to my legislature, go out and talk with parents. I'm talking with my students. I'm educating them so that they can educate their parents that they're talking with every single day. They're talking with their colleagues who really don't know the nuts and bolts of NCLB and whether it's good or whether it's bad. They need to make their decisions, but we need to educate them. They have to have understanding of what it means. before we can make change.
So you've become sort of an activist in looking at No Child Left Behind.
I have.
That's very interesting that it's motivated somebody in the field of education who hasn't been active to want to take more of a stance. Have you found...